Hello. When you think about martial arts, you probably think about the guys on your left, and you probably don't think about the guys on your right. And who could blame you? All the experts in the field of history tell you there were no personal combat skills involved. Tactics, strategy, yes, they are concerned about this a lot, but they don't give a damn about how people actually fought. Fencing historians and other experts on the subject are kind of biased. They think that fencing actually started in the 16th century, moved on, progressed, and evolved to its peak in 19th and 20th century. So, well, who could blame you that you know nothing about martial arts in medieval Europe? We were clueless as well. When I became the chief of reenactment group in 1998, I had no idea where to start, what to do, and our experiments were really nasty. And yet, we found that in the 14th and 15th century, the masters of fencing left us the books and depictions how to fight, which depicted how to fight. Then we stopped looking blind in the dark, we became fascinated with the sources, and finally we had something to hang on to. So we tried to diligently apply it into practice, and as with all things that you start, the first steps are not that good, but we are not ashamed of that. You have to start somewhere. What really changed the game for us was when we realized that there is a whole community of people interested in the same thing as we do. So this exchange of information, this exchange of training methods allowed us to really delve deep into the subject. We realized that it's not enough to look at the pictures alone. This is what fencing historians did, and they failed. What is important are those scribbles over there. Once you start to read this text, once you start to understand the language and what they actually say, the whole new world unlocks in front of you. And this world is very different from the one that is painted in the movies and in the history books. For example, we realized that you can grip a sword in more ways than one. You can hold it with your thumb on the flat of the blade, and then you can use both edges to strike at your opponent. And so the phrase double-edged sword actually loses its meaning because both edges strike at the opponent and hurt him, not you. What's more, it's not only fighting with swords. They also knew how to handle daggers and employ very effective, very complex techniques like levers, keys, locks, throws. And this kind of fight is what modern warfare experts turn to recently. Also, unarmed fighting in Europe, present, and you have all kind of attacks and defenses that you can think of. Kicks, strikes, throws, breaks, arm breaks. Fighting in armor looks absolutely different. You don't cut through the armor. You try to put the point of your sword in the gaps of the armor. The real armor is impenetrable to blows. Ground fighting in medieval Europe, long before Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Who knew? And what's most important, mounted combat was also not only reliant on the fighting with lances. You also could fence on horseback. You also could wrestle on horseback. It was very sophisticated, very deceitful, and they really tried to prepare themselves as good as they could for fighting, because in the real fight, anything goes. You had to know the tricks, you had to know the techniques, and you had to know and be prepared for combat. And what is very important is that we can find evidence that this kind of activity was part of their daily life. And what we are really hoping for is that this kind of activity will also become part of our daily life in modern times. Thank you.